Good morning, and welcome to the United Church of Christ Congregational of San Luis Obispo. My name is Pastor Jason, and I welcome you in the name of Jesus to this time of worship together, to this time of being together in spirit, if not necessarily standing and sitting right next to each other. Anastasia, who's our liturgist this morning, said, gosh, it's kind of weird to be here and not have anyone in the church. And I agree. It's probably weird for you being at home and hearing me and yet not being able to interact with me at all. Gosh, we're doing our best right now, all of us. We're all doing our best. So welcome to this time together. Our mission here at UCC SLO is to love, to do justice, and to walk humbly with our God. As a way of trying to put some wind in our sails this morning, I invite you now to rise in spirit and to join me in singing Shouts of Joy. If that doesn't put wind in your sails, I don't know what will.
Shouts of joy and victory resound in the house of the people of our God. One, two, shouts of joy and victory resound in the house of the people of our God. Shouts of joy and victory resound in the house of the our God's right hand has done mighty things for us. Our God's right hand has lifted high. Our God's right hand has done mighty things for us. Our God reigns on high. Our God reigns on high. Shouts of joy and victory resound in the house of the people. God's right hand has done mighty things for us. Our God's right hand has lifted high. Our God's right hand has done mighty things for us. Our God reigns on high. Our God reigns on high. Shouts of joy and victory resound in the house of the people of our God.
Amen. Now that our heart rates are up, our spirits are maybe a little bit more up, welcome. Welcome to our time of worship together. I invite you to check in, to say hello in the comment section on our Facebook page, and just say hi to one another, and also in a moment, share who and what you are grateful for, and then later on in the service, as we are approaching our prayer time, share the people and the situations, the places that are weighing on your heart this morning, and we will pray for them together. So, first off, I have a couple of announcements, and first off, tomorrow is People's Kitchen. Thank you, Linda and Davia, for organizing. Thank you, everyone who is cooking and everyone who has contributed to this. This is really a core ministry of our church. People got to eat. In fact, the service today, the sermon is all about God realizing that people got to eat and giving them daily bread. So thank you for supporting this important ministry. And also, thank you to everyone who helped clean up our neighborhood yesterday, who helped clean up Laguna Lake. Yesterday was EcoSlo's coastal cleanup. And thank you for keeping God's creation looking beautiful and taking pride in our neighborhood. So now I invite us to turn to our time of gratitudes. If you have someone or something to be grateful for, please share them now in the comment section. The handful of us here, feel free to share what you're grateful for. I'm going to start off by saying I am so grateful for our firefighters who are keeping us safe. I'm grateful that the air is better. I'm grateful that we can see the sun again. It was a challenging week, and trying to breathe, and gosh, my eyes were on fire all week, it felt like. I'm so grateful that it's clearer today. And also, I'm super excited to be here with the handful of folks gathered here today. So that's who and what I am grateful for this morning. If you've got a gratitude, raise your hand and let's share it. Diane?
Well, I am so grateful that I remembered that the sky is blue, so we did see that. And I'm also grateful for all the people that I asked prayer for something that I was really anguishing about. And when the event happened, it was without any worry or any deepness or any darkness, and it was a lifting. And so I want to thank everyone who partnered in it, well, with me. You know, we're knit by what we ask for, and people reach Amen. Out and to you. And so thank God for delivering his promise, because he is the Lord of peace. Yeah. So
praise God. Yeah. Amen. Christy?
I'm really grateful. My daughter's boyfriend, Ryan, had a terrible event. He, because of an anomaly in his anatomy, his vein was being compressed, and it built up a huge clot. And his whole leg swelled up. That's how he knew, in severe pain. And he went in, and the first surgeon messed up, basically. They tore his vena cava, and it was very scary. It was terrifying. And so he came home, and we were on watch, basically, breaking up the clot, but also at the same time, he doesn't bleed out. And it was very scary. And praise God, he's getting better every day, and he's getting around his own now. And I'm just so grateful. So
wonderful.
Grateful.
So. Thank God for faithfulness, for the prayers of friends. Thank God for Ryan's improved health. Amen. Any others? Yes, Anastasia.
I'm incredibly grateful for the lessons of unconditional love that I've been learning over the past several months. I've needed, actually, to be in solitude. It's been a really powerful experience for me, and I've been working on seeing the blessings and everything that happens in God's world, and I'm just really grateful for healing and closure. Someone very dear to me and I have reconciled, and it's just making my heart very full. And, you know, relationships transform and things change, and if we can carry the love through, it's just such a miracle. And so I'm just really grateful for the miracle of unconditional love today.
Amen. Mm-hmm. Amen. Any others? All right. Well, at this time, I'm going to turn it over to Anastasia, who's going to lead us in the call to worship and opening prayer.
Good morning, everybody. Let us all stand together in spirit for our call to worship. God, sometimes the days are long, the nights are even longer, and we are so tired. And then you soothe us and bring us to gentle places. You are our shepherd, and we don't need a thing. Sometimes the valley is dark and the shadows are heavy, and we're afraid. Then we feel your strength, and we have courage. You are our shepherd, and we don't need a thing. We will praise you and dwell with you forever, O God. We will worship you this day and always. Amen. Please join me in the opening prayer. Loving God, We thank you for your presence in our lives, even when we don't recognize it. As we find healing in our hearts and lives, help us to be a source of healing for others. Amen.
Beautiful song, and I love those lyrics. Before our time of prayer and meditation, I invite you to join me in reading from Matthew chapter 20, verses 1 through 16. So all throughout this year, we've been reading a lot from Matthew's gospel, and that is purposeful. We follow a schedule of readings that 1 year emphasizes Matthew, the next year emphasizes Mark, the next Luke, and John is kind of interspersed all throughout the years. And so we're about to finish up Matthew. This is Matthew 21 through 16, and this is Jesus teaching here. He says, "For the kingdom of heaven is like a landowner who went out early in the morning to hire laborers for his vineyard. After agreeing with the laborers for the usual daily wage, he sent them into his vineyard. When he went out about 9 o'clock, he saw others standing idle in the marketplace, and he said to them, 'You also go into the vineyard, and I will pay you whatever is right.' And so they went. When he went out again about noon and about 3 o'clock, he went out and found others standing around, and he said to them, 'Why are you standing here idle all day?' They said to him, 'Because no one has hired us.' And he said to them, 'You also go into the vineyard.' When evening came, the owner of the vineyard said to his manager, 'Call the laborers and give them their pay, beginning with the last and then going to the first.' When those hired about 5 o'clock came, each of them received the usual daily wage. Now when the first came, they thought they would receive more, but each of them also received the usual daily wage. And when they received it, they grumbled against the landowner, saying, 'These last worked only 1 hour, and you have made them equal to us who have borne the burden of the day and the scorching heat.' But he replied to one of them, 'Friend, I am doing you no wrong. Did you not agree with me for the usual daily wage? Take what belongs to you and go. I choose to give to this last the same as I give to you. Am I not allowed to do what I choose with what belongs to me? Or are you envious because I am generous? So the last will be first, and the first will be last.'" Amen. Loving God, we thank you for this time together. We thank you for the ability to share this time together through contemporary technology. God, we ask that you keep us together through this challenging time. Remind us that one day we will be together again. We will be able to stand together and sit together and to eat together. God, we long for that day when it is safe to do so. We will wait until it is safe, though, God. We pause now, God, to just come in touch with what we're feeling. Every week it feels like there's another challenge, another stressor. It's so much, God, that we need time to truly check in with ourselves and name what we're feeling. So we pause now, God, to do this. Eternal God, we lift up all of those whose hearts are heavy this morning. We think of the family and the friends of Ruth Bader Ginsburg. God, it was such a shock to hear of her passing. She was a woman who advocated for the vulnerable, for the excluded. God, be with her family and friends. Be with our nation now. Be with the family of Emily Wilkinson. Be with beloved Mike and Kathy and Sanja, and Dear Dee and Ray and Vince and Keith and Joyce. God, be with Fritz. Be with our courageous firefighters, our heroes, and the other first responders.
Lord, I pray for uplift Kenny in his travels to come, for Sierra, Kendra, for my cousins Beverly, Sister Mary, and for all of those whose hearts are heavy today. We ask for your hand upon us today, and we're just searching, Lord, but we don't want to be afraid. Give us peace today, Father.
Gracious God, we thank you for sustaining us in this time. We look forward to the day when this chapter will be behind us. In the meantime, we keep our eyes fixed on the author and the perfecter of our faith, Jesus. Promise to be with us always, including now. And the one who taught us to pray together, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Okay, get real cozy because this is a long one, guys. Our scripture is taken from Exodus 16, 2 through 15. The whole congregation of the Israelites complained against Moses and Aaron in the wilderness. The Israelites said to them, "If only we had died by the hand of the Lord in the land of Egypt, when we sat by the flesh pots and ate our fill of bread. For you have brought us out into this wilderness to kill this whole assembly with hunger." Then the Lord said to Moses, "I am going to rain bread from heaven for you, and each day the people shall go out and gather enough for that day. In that way I will test them, whether they will follow my instruction or not. On the sixth day, when they prepare what they bring in, it will be twice as much as they gather on other days." So Moses and Aaron said to all the Israelites, "In the evening you shall know that it was the Lord who brought you out of the land of Egypt. And in the morning you shall see the glory of the Lord, because he has heard your complaining against the Lord. For what are we that you complain against us?" And Moses said, "When the Lord gives you meat to eat in the evening, and your fill of bread in the morning, because the Lord has heard the complaining that you utter against him, what are we? Your complaining is not against us, but against the Lord." Then Moses said to Aaron, "Say to the whole congregation of the Israelites, draw near to the Lord, for he has heard your complaining." And as Aaron spoke to the whole congregation of Israelites, he looked toward the wilderness, and the glory of the Lord appeared in the cloud. The Lord spoke to Moses and said, "I have heard the complaining of the Israelites. Say to them, at twilight, you shall eat meat, and in the morning, you shall have your fill of bread. Then you shall know that I am the Lord your God." In the evening, quails came up and covered the camp, and in the morning, there was a layer of dew around the camp. When the layer of dew lifted, there on the surface of the wilderness was a fine, flaky substance, as fine as the frost on the ground. When the Israelites saw it, they said to one another, "What is it?" For they did not know what it was. Moses said to them, "It is the bread that the Lord has given you to eat."
Thank you, Anastasia. The book of Exodus is the centerpiece of the Torah, the first five books of the Bible. It was the most important book of the first five to the ancient Israelites and to the later Jews. It's a book about liberation. It's about God intervening in real space and real time through an individual that God called. It was a young man named Moses that God called to liberate the Israelites. In chapters 1 through 5, the beginning of Exodus, God heard the cries of the Israelites who were enslaved in Egypt. They were oppressed and they were suffering, and they called out to God to rescue them. "You made a promise to our ancestor Abraham, God, don't you remember? We are Abraham's descendants. You were going to bless all of creation through him and through us. If you're going to do that, you are going to need to help us now, God. Hello, are you there? We need you." So God heard them, and God called on Moses to liberate them. In chapters 5 through 18, the middle section, it chronicles what happened after the Israelites are liberated from Egypt. When they wandered through the wilderness, complaining the whole time. And then lastly, chapters 19 through the end of Exodus, God teaches the Israelites how to live, how to choose life and how to choose love, how to respect each other, and how to honor God. The Ten Commandments, for example, are in Exodus chapter 20. There's lots of instruction on how to live healthy in Exodus. God tried to teach the Israelites through the remainder of this book how to live peacefully and justly. The book of Exodus was absolutely foundational to the Israelites and to the later Jews. It was critical for their life and their faith and their self-understanding. It was actually more foundational than Genesis. The Israelites understood God as liberator before they understood God as creator. God is the one who liberates was everything to the early Israelites. God was the one who was faithful, the one who would rescue God's people. God was the one who would journey with people in times of trial. And God would teach people how to live with justice and peace. That's the message of Exodus. And it's still important to Jewish folks today. And not only them, it's important to Muslims and to Christians. These first five books of the Bible, the Torah, are sacred scripture to all three of our traditions. Now, the passage that Anastasia just read was from the middle section, chapter 16. It's after Moses liberated the Israelites from Egypt, and now they're in the wilderness, and they're restless. And then they start to get hangry. Hangry, have you heard this word before? It is a terrible, awful combination of hungry and angry. The Israelites are hangry. Can you give me a thumbs up if you have ever been hangry? It's not pretty. You say and you do things that you would not normally say or do. I recently saw a t-shirt that said, "I'm sorry for what I said when I was hangry." The Israelites were hangry, and they started complaining to Moses and his brother Aaron, who helped liberate them. "If only we had stayed in the land of Egypt when we sat by the flesh pots and ate our fill of bread. You have brought us out into this wilderness to kill the whole assembly with hunger." Gosh, if we knew that this is what it meant to be rescued and liberated, God, we would have stayed in Egypt. At least we had food there. Jeez. They sound a little ungrateful. And yet, they're just being honest. They were hungry, desperately hungry, and they were tired, and they were lost. And they wondered if Moses knew what he was doing or where he was going. So they cried out to God again, and God heard them. And God said that every morning bread would rain down from heaven, and that every evening quail would gather. So the Israelites could eat quail in the evening and then bread in the morning. And that would sustain them on their long journey. God also told them that one day a week they needed to rest. So the day before they rest, gather enough bread to sustain them on this day of rest so that they didn't have to do anything. But only on this one day, all the other days, just gather up your daily bread. Now, I love that God didn't say, what a bunch of ungrateful, miserable, whiny, complainy people. You cried out to me, and I rescued you. You're free now, and all you do is complain. God didn't do that. Just like when they were in Egypt, God heard their cries, and God responded. Because God had promised to be with them and to love them in good times and in bad times. God had promised to be faithful. That's what it means to be in covenant. It's like a marriage. You're faithful. God was faithful. Even when the Israelites were not faithful to God, God was still faithful to them. God heard their cries and intervened. And dear friends, I hear a word in this story for us here today. We have many things in common with the Israelites in the wilderness. 2020 has given us a challenge, and then a greater challenge, and then an even greater challenge, and then another even bigger challenge. It just doesn't seem to stop. We are now 6 months in to a global pandemic. And I don't know about you, but I felt a psychic shift these past couple of weeks. I've talked with so many people who have said, you know, this has been going on for 6 months. And I said, I know. I know. I realize that too. And I think at this point we're all tired. We're all restless. We don't know what's happening. And we wonder if our leaders will get us through this time, just like the ancient Israelites. And I think it is absolutely okay to be honest about how we're feeling. In fact, acknowledging our feelings is a necessary step for healing and for liberation. When we cry out, when we name names, God hears and God acts. Just like when the Israelites were in Egypt, when they were in the wilderness. There is wisdom, there is deep wisdom in the story that can help us navigate this most challenging time. One of the most important takeaways from this story is the need for daily sustenance right now, the need for daily bread. We don't need a lot. We just need enough to keep us going spiritually and psychologically each day. We awaken hungry. Frankly, we awaken hangry. Especially if you read or you watch the news first thing in the morning. I am trying not to do that right now. It just makes my blood pressure spike every time. We wake up depleted, exhausted, angry, frustrated. We need to ground ourselves with the promises of God each and every day right now. We need to remember God's faithfulness and one another's friendship every day right now. My good friend and my former pastor, Jane, also records a daily devotional on Facebook. And she calls her reflection Morning Manna. It's a scripture reading or a prayer or a spiritual practice or a personal reflection. Morning Manna is a reference to this story from Exodus. It's an awareness that every day we need something to meditate on in order to give us the strength to get through this journey. We need something to sustain ourselves every day right now. I'm doing the same thing with the Peace Nugget. It's a bit of daily bread to help keep all of us, including me, that's part of the reason that I'm doing this, we need to keep ourselves in tune with the eternal right now. It is absolutely impossible to try to predict or to plan a year from now or 6 months from now. If I'm honest, I don't even know how to plan for next week. It feels like the best that we can do for right now is to be faithful today, to be mindful today, and to be hopeful today, to choose love and life today. Throughout this pandemic, I feel like I'm understanding and appreciating the wisdom of the recovery community more and more. The wisdom of one day at a time. Staying sober today, that's enough. I've spoken with friends who are in recovery, and we talk about the challenging times, and they share what's going on for them, and they say, but do you know what? I'm sober, and I'm going to be sober. I'm going to stay sober. I'm not going to drink tonight. And I say, praise God. Let's just keep doing this. Let's just keep staying sober every day. We need to choose hope today and faith and love. We need to remember God's faithfulness today. And that is enough. Give us this day our daily bread. We pray it together every week. Jesus, who was Jewish after all, knew the story of Exodus. It was foundational to every Jew, including him. Give us enough bread for today. And that's enough. The story from Exodus has another important reminder for us today. Don't romanticize the past. The Israelites hated being slaves in Egypt. They cried out to God and asked to be liberated. And yet, when they were freed, what did they say? Oh, if only we could have stayed in Egypt. Then at least we could be eating right now. You know, on further thought, things weren't so bad. There were some perks. We could have gotten used to it. It wasn't all that bad. No, it was awful, y'all. It was so bad that you cried out to God to be rescued. It is so human of us to romanticize the past. I have found myself thinking so many times, boy, this 2020 is for the birds. If only it could be 2019 again. Jeff and I were talking, if only it could be January again. January wasn't that bad, or February, I can barely remember it, but it wasn't all that bad. Well, do you know what? Probably in January and February, and in 2019 even, I was probably thinking, oh, this stinks. If only it could be 2018 again. Well, do you know what? 2018 was pretty bad too. Our minds trick us into thinking that the past was better than it was. That job that you left, that you long for now, that job was awful, and that's why you left. Don't start romanticizing it now. That relationship that you ended, that you long for now, it wasn't working. It was so bad you ended it. Don't start romanticizing it It's an illusion. It's your brain making you think that something was better than it really was. God has better things in store for us than anything we have done or experienced before. Don't settle for what has been. Don't long to be a slave in Egypt again. God doesn't liberate us only to return us to the past. God calls us into the future, a future that is greater than anything that we have experienced in our past. Don't settle. Don't go backward. The final word that the wilderness story has for us today is the importance of rest. Rest was something that the Pharaoh in Egypt forbade, but God insisted on. God told them to rest one whole day a week. And God even made it possible for them to do it. God provided enough manna for 2 days, one day a week, so that they could rest for an entire day, even if it was unusual and uncomfortable at first. Even if it was something that the Israelites didn't think that they needed. God knew that the only way they would make it through this time in the wilderness was if they rested. God's beloved, the only way that we will make it through this challenging time is if we rest also. We must make rest and self-care a priority right now. And resting doesn't mean watching the news or spending extra time on social media either. That is not rest. It means stopping all of this busyness, all of this stuff that we're doing that we think we need to do. It's just making us more anxious and more restless and more discouraged and more afraid. We need to stop all that. Instead, we need to call friends and family members or text. If you're a texter, text. We need to be reading books right now. We need to be creating art. We need to be praying and meditating and exercising and doing things that are strengthening our spirits and our bodies right now. TVs off. Social media off. I keep hearing about a new documentary on Netflix about how social media is intentionally trying to just drive a wedge between Americans and make us hate each other even more than we already do. We don't need any help with that right now. Turn it off. Turn off your TV, your social media, put your newspapers away. No doing. Just be. Just rest at least one day a week right now. If you are a Martha, like I am, you can't even conceive of resting a whole day. That's fine. Start with an hour or two, and then three or four, and then build yourself up to a whole day. We need a break. We need to take care of ourselves now. Dear friends, when the Israelites cried out to God to be liberated, God heard them, and God intervened. God gave them their daily bread. God reminded them not to romanticize the past, and God reminded them to rest. And God calls all of us to do the same things today. May God give us this day our daily bread. May God help us to be present today. And may God help us rest. Amen. Please pray with me. Oh God, we thank you for your faithfulness, for your covenant faithfulness. God, we can call out to you. We can rely on you. We can reach out and know that you are with us. You are with our world in this challenging time. God, continue to guide us in our time in the wilderness. Amen. I invite us now to consider sharing a gift, an offering with the church, in order to help us continue our mission in this challenging time. I can think of no other time when we are more needed, when a message of unconditional love, of inclusion, of radical hospitality and love is more needed. So please, I ask you to consider sharing a gift with this church. You can also share a gift with New Life Canines, either writing in the memo line of a check, New Life Canines, or online through the Nonprofit Impact Fund. We're getting real close to the $10,000 goal that we set for New Life Canines. So please, choose this time to make a difference in our world. Make this a time to choose love and hope.
Praise God, one love we all may share. Praise God, one beauty everywhere. Praise God, one hope of good to be. Praise God, one truth that makes us free.
Gracious God, help us to reflect your love by listening to your call and to your will for our lives. We dedicate these gifts in the name of the one who always heard and answered your call. Amen.
Shadow.
great is God's faithfulness. I invite you now to join me in affirming our faith. And this week's affirmation actually comes from our friends in the Disciples of Christ. So you are welcome to say with me, "We rejoice in God, maker of heaven and earth, and in the covenant of love which binds to God and one another. Through baptism into Christ, we enter into newness of life and are made one with the whole people of God. In the communion of the Holy Spirit, we are joined together in discipleship and in obedience to Christ. In the bonds of Christian faith, we yield ourselves to God that we may serve the one whose kingdom has no end. Blessing, glory, and honor be to God forever. Amen." God's beloved, may we remember that God is at our side, even in the valleys of death. May we remember that God's Spirit abides in us and surrounds us with love and mercy all the days of our life. Go in peace to love and to serve our God. Amen. And you're welcome to join me in saying the Serenity Prayer. God, grant me the serenity to accept the things I cannot change, the courage to change the things that I can, and the wisdom to know the difference. Amen. May peace begin today with us, and may God give us this day our daily bread. Dear friends, we love you, and we miss you. We will see you again in real life as soon as it's safe. Take good care. Bye-bye.